Most of his time he would spend in his room, with the door locked upon the inside. But sometimes he would emerge in a sort of drunken frenzy, and would burst out of the house and tear about the garden with a revolver in his hand, screaming out that he was afraid of no man, and that he was not to be cooped up, like a sheep in a pen, by man or devil. When these hot fits were over, however, he would rush tumultuously in at the door and lock and bar it behind him, like a man who can brazen it out no longer against the terror which lies at the roots of his soul. At such times I have seen his face, even on a cold day, glisten with moisture, as though it were new raised from a basin. Well, to come to an end of the matter, Mr. Holmes, and not to abuse your patience, there came a night when he made one of those drunken sallies from which he never came back. We found him, when we went to search for him, face downward in a little green-scummed pool which lay at the foot of the garden. There was no sign of any violence, and the water was but 2 feet deep, so that the jury, having regard to his known eccentricity, brought in a verdict of suicide. But I, who knew how he winced from the very thought of death, had much ado to persuade myself that he had gone out of his way to meet it. The matter passed, however, and my father entered into possession of the estate and of some £14,000, which lay to his credit at the bank.
"One moment," Holmes interposed. "Your statement is, I foresee, one of the most remarkable to which I have ever listened. Let me have the date of the reception by your uncle of the letter, and the date of his supposed suicide."
The letter arrived on March 10th, 1883. His death was 7 weeks later, upon the night of May 2nd.
"Thank you. Pray proceed."
When my father took over the Horsham property, he, at my request, made a careful examination of the attic, which had been always locked up. We found the brass box there, although its contents had been destroyed. On the inside of the cover was a paper label with the initials of KKK repeated upon it, and letters, memoranda, receipts, and a register written beneath. These, we presume, indicated the nature of the papers which had been destroyed by Colonel Openshaw. For the rest, there was nothing of much importance in the attic, save a great many scattered papers and notebooks bearing upon my uncle's life in America. Some of them were of the wartime and showed that he had done his duty well and had borne the repute of a brave soldier. Others were of a date during the reconstruction of the southern states and were mostly concerned with politics, for he had evidently taken a strong part in opposing the carpet-bag politicians who had been sent down from the north. Well, it was the beginning of 84 when my father came to live at Horsham, and all went as well as possible with us until the January of 85. On the fourth day after the new year, I heard my father give a sharp cry of surprise as we sat together at the breakfast table. There he was, sitting with a newly opened envelope in one hand, and 5 dried orange pips in the outstretched palm of the other one. He had always laughed at what he called my cock-and-bull story about the colonel, but he looked very scared and puzzled now that the same thing had come upon himself.
"Why, what on earth does this mean, John?" he stammered.
My heart had turned to lead. "It is KKK," said I. He looked inside the envelope. "So it is," he cried. "Here are the very letters. But what is this written above them?" "Put the papers on the sundial," I read, peeping over his shoulder.
"What papers? What sundial?" he asked.
"The sundial in the garden." "There is no other," said I. "But the papers must be those that are destroyed."
"Pooh," said he, gripping hard at his courage. "We are in a civilized land here, and we can't have tomfoolery of this kind. Where does the thing come from?"
"From Dundee," I answered, glancing at the postmark.
"Some preposterous practical joke," said he.
"What have I to do with sundials and papers? I shall take no notice of such nonsense."
"I should certainly speak to the police," I said.
"And be laughed at for my pains?"
"Nothing of the sort."
"Then let me do so."
"No, I forbid you. I won't have a fuss made about such nonsense."
It was in vain to argue with him, for he was a very obstinate man. I went about, however, with a heart which was full of forebodings.